Hello there. It is a rainy October evening. The children are abed. You know what that means? It's story time. Let's continue. His Majesty's Dragon, Book One of the Temeraire series by Naomi Novik. We were making our way through Chapter 12, getting towards the dramatic climax of the book. And Mr. Holland has just been nominated as the future captain of an egg that's going to hatch for a Winchester. And let's hear what happens next. Holland stared when Lawrence relieved him of his duties, and he said a little helplessly, "My own dragon?" He had to turn away and hide his face. Lawrence pretended not to see. "Sir, I don't know how to thank you," he said, whispering to keep his voice from breaking. "I have promised you will be a credit to the service, to see to it, that you do not make me a liar, and I will be content," Lawrence said, and shook his hand. "You must go at once. The hatching is expected at almost any day, and there is a carriage waiting for you to take you to Chatham." Looking dazed, Holland accepted Lawrence's hand and the bag with his few possessions which his fellows on the ground crew had hastily packed for him, then allowed himself to be led off towards the waiting carriage by young Dyer. The crew were beaming upon him as they went. He was obliged to shake a great many hands until Lawrence feared he would never get under way, and said, "Gentlemen, the wind is still in the north. Let us get some of this armor off Temeraire for the night and put them to work." Temeraire watched him go, a little sadly. "I am very glad that the new dragon will have him instead of Rankin, but I wish they had given him to Levitas sooner, and perhaps Holland would have kept him from dying," he said to Lawrence as the crew worked on him. "We cannot know what would have happened," Lawrence said, "but I am not certain Levitas could ever have been happy with such an exchange. Even at the end, he only wanted Rankin's affection, as strange as that seems to us." Lawrence slept with Temeraire again that evening, close and sheltered in his arms and wrapped in several woolen blankets against the early frost. He woke just before first light to see the barren treetops bending away from the sunrise, an easterly wind blowing from France. "Temeraire," he called quietly, and the great head rose up from above him to sniff the air. The wind has changed," Temeraire said, and bent down to nuzzle him. Lawrence allowed himself the indulgence of 5 minutes, lying warm and embraced, with his hands resting on the narrow, tender scales of Temeraire's nose. Oh, man, could you imagine what that could be like? "I hope I've never given you cause for unhappiness, my dear," he said softly. "Never, Lawrence," Temeraire said, very low. The ground crew came hurrying from the barracks the moment he touched the bell. The chain mesh had been left in the clearing under a cloth, and Temeraire had slept in the heavy harness for this once. He was quickly fitted out, while the other side of the clearing, Granby reviewed every man's harness and carabiners. Lawrence submitted to his inspection as well, and then took a moment to clean and reload his pistols fresh, and belt on his sword. The sky was cold and white, a few darker gray clouds scudding like shadows. No orders had come yet. At Lawrence's request, Temeraire lifted him up to his shoulder and reared onto his hind legs, and he could see the dark line of the ocean past the trees, and the ships bobbing in the harbor. The wind came strongly into his face, cold and salt. "Thank you, Temeraire," he said, and Temeraire set him down again. "Mr. Granby, we will get the crew aboard," Lawrence said. The crew came up. The ground crew put up a great noise, more a roar than a cheer, as Temeraire rose into the air. Lawrence could hear it echoed throughout the covert as the other great beasts beat up into the sky. Maximus was a great blazing presence in his gray red-gold brilliance, dwarfing the others. Victoriatus and Lily also stood out against the crowd of smaller yellow reapers. Lenten's flag was streaming from his dragon Obversaria, the golden angle wing. She was only a little larger than the reapers, but she cut through the crowd of dragons and took the lead with effortless grace, her wings rotating almost as did Temeraire's. As the larger dragons had been set on independent duty, Temeraire did not need to keep the formation speed. He quickly negotiated a position near the leading edge of the force. The wind was in their faces, cold and damp, and the low, whistling shriek of their passage carried away all noise, leaving only the leathery snap of Temeraire's wings, each beat like a sail going taut, and the creaking of the harness. Oh, can you imagine? The combined forces of England to defend the country are in the air. The whole aerial corps that is left in England is turned out to face Napoleon's wrath, his aerial legions. Nothing else broke the unnatural, heavy silence of the crew. They were already drawn in sight. They were already drawn in sight. At this distance, the French dragons seemed a cloud of gulls or sparrows. So many were they, and wheeling so in unison. The French were keeping at a considerable height, some 900 feet above the surface of the water, well out of range of even the longest pepper guns. Below them, a lovely and futile spread of white sail, the Channel Fleet. Many of the ships wreathed in smoke where they had tried a hopeless shot. More of the ships had taken up positions nearer the land, despite the terrible danger of placing themselves so close to a leeward shore. If the French could be forced to land very near the edge of the cliffs, they might yet come into range of the long guns, if briefly. Ixidium and Mortiferous were racing back from Trafalgar at frantic speed with their formations, but they could not hope to arrive before the end of the week. There was not a man among them, but had known a nicety the numbers which the French could muster against them. Rationally, there had never been any cause for hope. Even so, it was a different thing to see those numbers made flesh and wing. Fully 12 of the light wooden transports which Rankin had spied out, each carried by 4 dragons and defended by as many more besides. Lawrence had never heard of such a force in modern warfare. It was the stuff of the Crusades, when dragons had been smaller and the country more wild, the more easily to feed them. This occurring to him, Lawrence turned to Granby and said calmly, loud enough to carry back to the men, "The logistics of feeding so many dragons together must be impractical for any extended period. He will not be able to try this again soon." Granby only stared at him a moment. Then, with a start, he said hurriedly, "Just so. Right you are. Should we give the men a little exercise? I think we have at least half an hour's grace before we meet them." "Very good," Lawrence said, pushing himself up to his feet. The force of the wind was great, but braced against his straps, he was able to turn around. The men did not quite like to meet his eyes, but there was an effect. Back straightened. Whispers stopped. None of them cared to show fear or reluctance to his face. "Mr. Johns, exchange of positions, if you please." "Wait, Mr. Johns, exchange of positions, if you please," Granby called through his speaking trumpet. Shortly, the topmen and bellmen had run through their exchange under the direction of their lieutenants, and the men were warmed up against the biting wind. Their faces looked a little less pinched. They could not engage in true gunnery practice with the other crews so close, but with a commendable show of energy, Lieutenant Riggs had his riflemen fire blanks to loosen their fingers. Dune had long, thin hands, at present bled white with cold. As he struggled to reload, his powder horn slipped out of his fingers and nearly went over the side. Collins only saved it by leaning nearly straight out from Temeraire's back, just barely catching the cord. Temeraire glanced back once as the shots went off, but straightened himself again without any reminder. He was flying easily, at a pace which he could have sustained for the better part of a day. His breathing was not labored or even much quickened. His only difficulty was an excess of high spirits. As the French dragons came more closely into view, he succumbed to excitement and put on a burst of speed, but at the touch of Lawrence's hand, he drew back again into the line. The French defenders had formed into a loosely woven line of battle. The larger dragons above, with the smaller ones beneath, in a darting, unpredictable mass, forming a wall shielding the transport vessels with their carriers. Lawrence felt if only they could break through the line, there might be some hope. The carriers, most of them of the middleweight Pêcheure breed, were laboring greatly. The unaccustomed weight was telling on them, and he was sure they'd be vulnerable to an attack. but they had 23 dragons to the French 40 or more defenders, and almost a quarter of the British force was made up of Greylings and Winchesters, no proper match for the combat weight dragons. Getting through the line would be nearly impossible, and once through, any attacker would immediately be isolated and vulnerable in turn. On Versaria, Lenten set up flags for the attack. Engage enemy more closely, was the flag signal. Lawrence felt his own heart begin beating faster, with the tremble of excitement that would fade only after the first moments of battle. He raised the speaking trumpet and called forward, "Choose your target, Temeraire. If ever you can get us alongside a transport, you cannot go wrong." In the confusion of the enormous crowd of dragons, he trusted Temeraire's instincts better than his own. If there was a gap in the French line, Lawrence was sure that Temeraire would see it. By way of answer, Temeraire struck out immediately for one of the outlying transports, as if he meant to go straight at it. Abruptly, he folded his wings and dived, and the three French dragons who had closed ranks in front of him dashed in pursuit. Swiveling his wings, Temeraire halted himself in midair while the three went flashing past, and with a few mighty wing strokes, he was now flying directly up towards the unprotected belly of the first carrier on the larboard side. And now Lawrence could see that this dragon, a smaller female pêcheure, was visibly tired, her wings laboring even though her pace was still regular. "Ready, bombs!" Lawrence shouted as Temeraire came hurtling past the pêcheure and slashed at the French dragon's side. The crew hurled the bombs onto the deck of the transport. The crack of gunfire came from the pêcheure's back, and Lawrence heard a cry behind him. Collins threw up his arms and went limp in his harness, his rifle tumbling away into the water below. A moment later, the body followed. He was dead, and one of the others had cut him loose. You know, they don't come back for those folks in the midst of battle, I guess. There were no guns on the transport itself, but the deck was built slanting like a roof. Three of the bombs rolled off before they could burst, drifting smoke as they fell, uselessly. However, two exploded in time. The whole transport sagged in midair as the shock briefly threw the pêcheure off her pace, gaping holes torn in the wooden planking. Lawrence caught a single glimpse of a pale, staring face inside, smudged with dirt and inhuman with terror. Then Temeraire was angling away. Blood was dripping from somewhere below, a thin black stream. Lawrence leaned to check, but saw no injury. Temeraire was flying well.
"Granby!" he shouted, pointing.
"From his claws, the other beast!"
Granby shouted back after a moment, and Lawrence nodded. But there was no opportunity for a second pass. Two more French dragons were coming at them directly. Temeraire beat up quickly into the sky, the enemy beasts following. They had seen his trick of maneuvering and were coming at a more cautious pace so as not to overrun him.
"Double back, straight down and at them," Lawrence called to Temeraire.
"Guns ready,"
Riggs shouted behind them as Temeraire drew a deep, swelling breath and neatly turned back on himself in midair. No longer at war with gravity, he plummeted towards the French dragons, roaring furiously. The tremendous volume rattled Lawrence's bones, even in the face of the wind. The dragon in the lead recoiled, shrieking, and entangled the head of the second on its wing. Temeraire flew straight down between them through the bitter smoke of the enemy gunfire, the British rifles speaking an answer. Several of the enemy dead were already cut loose and falling. Temeraire lashed out and carved a gash along the second dragon's flank as they went past. The spurting blood splashed Lawrence's trousers, fever hot against his skin. They were away, and the two attackers were still struggling to right themselves. The first was flying very badly and making shrill noises of pain. Even as Lawrence glanced behind them, he saw the dragons being turned back for France. With their advantage in numbers, Bonaparte's aviators had no need to push their dragons past injury.
"Bravely done," Lawrence called, unable to keep jubilation,
pride out of his voice, as absurd as it was to indulge in such sentiments at the height of so desperate a battle. Behind him, the crew cheered wildly as the second of the French dragons pulled away to find another opponent, not daring to attempt Temeraire alone. At once, Temeraire was winging back towards their original target, head raised proudly. He was still unmarked. Their formation partner, Masoria, was at the transport. 30 years of experience made her and Sutton wily, and they too had won past the line of battle to continue the attack on the already weakened Pecher, whom Temeraire had injured. A pair of the smaller Pou de Ciel were defending the Pecher. Together they were more than Masoria's weight, but she was making use of every trick she had, skillfully baiting them forward, trying to make an opening for a dash at the Pecher. More smoke was pouring from the transport's deck. Sutton's crew had evidently managed to land a few more bombs upon it. "Flank to larboard," Sutton signaled from Masoria's back as they approached. Masoria made a dash at the two defenders to keep their attention on her, while Temeraire swept forward and lashed at the Pecher's side, her claws tearing through the chain mesh. With a hideous noise, dark blood spurted. Bellowing, instinctually trying to lash out at Temeraire in defense, the Pecher let go of the beam with one foreleg. It was secured to the dragon's body by many heavy chains, but even so, the transport listed visibly down, and Lawrence could hear the men yelling inside. Temeraire made an ungraceful but effective fluttering hop and avoided the strike, still closely engaged. He tore away more of the chain mesh and clawed the Pecher again. "Prepare volley!" Riggs bellowed, and the riflemen strafed the Pecher's back cruelly. Lawrence saw one of the French officers taking aim at Temeraire's head. He fired his own pistols, and with the second shot, the man went down, clutching his leg.
"Sir, permission to board!"
Granby called forward. The Pecher's top men and riflemen had suffered heavy losses. Its back was largely cleared, and the opportunity was ideal. Granby was standing at the ready with a dozen of the men, all of them with swords drawn and hands ready to unlock their carabiners. So that just gives you a sense of so Granby can go over with a dozen men. That's how many more crewmen are on Temeraire besides they could spare Granby and 12 others. Lawrence had been dreading this possibility of all things. It was only with deep reluctance that he gave Temeraire the word and laid them alongside the French dragon.
"Borders away!" he shouted, waving Granby his permission with a low, sinking feeling in his belly.
Nothing could have been more unpleasant than to watch his men take that terrifying, unharnessed leap into the waiting enemy's hands while he himself had to remain at his station. And, you know, this just made me realize as we compare what this mode of warfare, you know, this fantastic sort of, you know, alternative history form of warfare would be back then, we really have nothing to compare it to. There's no boarding of aerial planes, really, or anything like that, right? We don't have anything quite like this, where one plane pulls up next to the next plane and they jump over onto that plane. So it's pretty slick that, yeah, maybe with dragons you would have this sort of aerial depth-defying boarding happening from back to back or something like that. Pretty crazy. A terrible, ululating cry in the near distance. Lily had just struck a French dragon full in the face, and it was scrabbling and clawing at its own face, jerking in one direction and then the next, frenzied with pain. Temeraire's shoulders hunched with sympathy, just as the Pecher's did. Lawrence flinched himself at the intolerable sound. Then the screaming stopped abruptly. A sickening relief. The captain had crept out along the neck and put a bullet into his own dragon's head rather than see the creature die slowly as the acid ate through the skull and into the brain. Many of the crew had leapt to other dragons for safety, some even to Lily's back, but he had sacrificed the opportunity. Lawrence saw him falling alongside the tumbling dragon, and they plunged into the ocean together. He wrenched himself from the horrible fascination of the sight. The bloody struggle aboard the Pecher's back was going well for them, and he could already see a couple of the midwingmen working on the chains that secured the transport to the dragon. But the Pecher's distress had not gone unnoticed. Another French dragon was coming toward them at speed, with some exceptionally daring men were climbing out of the holes in the damaged transport, trying to make their way up to the chains of the Pecher's back to provide assistance. Even as Lawrence caught sight of them, a couple of them slipped on the sloping deck and fell. but there were more than a dozen making the attempt, and if they were to reach the Peshere, they would certainly turn the tide of battle against Granby and the borders. Masoria cried out then, a long, shrill wail. "Fall back!" Lawrence heard Sutton shouting. She was streaming dark blood from a deep cut across her breastbone. Another wound on her flank already being packed with white bandage, she dropped and wheeled away, leaving the two Pudiciel who had been attacking her at liberty. Though they were much smaller than Temeraire, he could not engage the Peshere while under attack from two directions. Lawrence had either to call back the boarding party or abandon them and hope they could take the Peshere, securing its surrender by seizing its captain alive.
"Granby!" Lawrence shouted. The lieutenant looked around, wiping blood from a cut on his face, and nodded as soon as he saw their position, waving them off.
Lawrence touched Temeraire's side and called to him, with a last parting slash across the Peshere's flank that laid the white bone bare. Temeraire spun away, gaining some distance, and hovered to permit them to survey. The two smaller French dragons did not pursue, but remained hovering close to the Peshere. They did not dare try to get close enough to send men over, for Temeraire could easily overwhelm them if they put themselves into so exposed a position. Yet Temeraire himself was also in some danger. The riflemen and half the bellmen had gone for the boarding party. Well worth the risk, for if they took the Peshere, the transport could not very well continue on, if it did not fall entirely. At least the three remaining dragons would likely be forced to turn back for France. But that meant Temeraire was now undermanned, and they were vulnerable to boarding themselves. They could not risk another close engagement. The boarding party was making steady progress now against the last man resisting aboard the Peshere's back. They would certainly outdistance the men from the transport. One of the Pudiciel dashed in and tried to lay us alongside the Peshere.
"At them!" Lawrence called, and Temeraire dived instantly, his raking claws and teeth sending the smaller beast into a hurried retreat.
Lawrence had to send Temeraire winging away again, but it had been enough. The French had lost their chance, and the Peshere was crying out in alarm, twisting her head around. Granby was standing at the French dragon's neck with a pistol aimed at a man's head. They had taken the captain. At Granby's order, the chains were flung off the Peshere, and they turned the captured French dragon's head towards Dover. She flew unwillingly and slowly, head turning back every few moments in anxiety for her captain, but she went, and the transport was left hanging wildly askew, the three remaining dragons struggling desperately under its weight. Lawrence had little opportunity to enjoy the triumph. Two French dragons came diving at them, a petit chevalier, considerably larger than Temeraire, despite the name, and a middleweight, Peshere Couronné, who had dashed to seize the sagging transport beam. The men still clinging to the roof threw the dangling chains to the French dragon's crew, and in moments the transport was righted and underway again. The Pudiciel were coming at them again from opposite sides, and the petit chevalier was angling round from behind. Their position was exposed and rapidly growing hopeless.
"Withdraw, Temeraire!" Lawrence called, bitter though the order was to give.
Temeraire turned away at once, but the pursuing dragons drew nearer. They had been fighting hard now for nearly half an hour, and he was tiring. The two Pudiciel were working in concert, trying to herd Temeraire's towards the big dragon, darting across his path of flight to slow him down. The Petit Chevalier suddenly put on a burst of speed, and as he drew alongside them, a handful of men leapt over.
"Where are borders?" Lieutenant John shouted in his hoarse baritone,
and Temeraire looked round in alarm. Fear gave him fresh energy to draw away from the pursuit. The Chevalier fell behind, and after Temeraire lashed out and caught one of the Pudiciel, they too abandoned the chase. However, there were 8 men already crossed over and latched on. Lawrence grimly reloaded his pistols, thrusting them into his belt, then lengthened his carabiner straps and stood. The 5 top men under Lieutenant Johns were trying to hold the borders at the middle of Temeraire's back. Lawrence made his way back as quickly as he dared. His first shot went wide. His second took a Frenchman directly in the chest. The man fell, coughing blood, and dangled limply from the harness. Then it was hot, frantic sword work. Kitting, king, ting, ting. With the sky whipping past too quickly to see anything but the men before him.
A French lieutenant was standing in front of him. A man saw his gold bars and aimed a pistol at him. Lawrence barely heard the speech the man tried to make him and paid no attention, but knocked the gun away with his sword arm and clubbed the Frenchman on the temple with his pistol butt. The lieutenant fell. The man behind him lunged, but the wind of their passage was against him. The sword thrust scarcely penetrated the leather coat Lawrence wore. Lawrence cut the man's harness straps and kicked him off with a boot to the middle, then looked around for more boarders. Just crazy. Just kicking him right off into the sky, dead, gone, you know. But by the good fortune, the others were all dead or disarmed, and for their part, only Challoner and Wright had fallen, except for Lieutenant Johns, who was hanging from his carabiners, blood welling up furiously from a pistol wound in his chest. Before they could try to tend him, he gave a final rasping gasp and was still. Lawrence bent down and closed John's dead, staring eyes and hung his own sword back on his belt. "Mr. Martin, take command of the top, acting lieutenant. Get these bodies cleared away." "Yes, sir," Martin said, panting. There was a bloody gash across his cheek and red splashes of blood in his yellow hair. "Is your arm all right, Captain?" Lawrence looked. Blood was seeping a little through the rent in his coat. But he could move the arm easily, and he felt no weakness. "Only a scratch. I will tie it up directly." He clambered over a body and back to his station at the neck and latched himself in tight, then pulled loose his neckcloth to wrap around the wound. "Boarders repelled," he called, and the nervous tension left Temeraire's shoulders. Temeraire had drawn away from the battlefield, as proper when boarded. Now he turned back around, and when Lawrence looked up, he could see the whole extent of the field of battle, where it was not obscured by smoke and dragon wings. All but three of the transports were under no sort of attack at all. The British dragons were being heavily engaged by the French defenders. Lily was flying virtually alone. Only Natidis remained with her. The others of their formation nowhere in Lawrence's sight. He looked for Maximus and saw him engaged closely with their old enemy, the Grand Chevalier. The intervening 2 months of growth had brought Maximus closer to his size, and two of them were tearing at each other in a terrible savagery. At this distance, the sound of the battle was muffled. Instead, he could hear a more fatal one entirely, the crash of the waves breaking upon the foot of the white cliffs. They had been driven nearly to shore, and he could see the red and white coats of the soldiers formed up on the ground. It was not yet midday. Abruptly, a phalanx of six heavyweight dragons broke off from the French line and dived towards the ground, all of them roaring at the top of their lungs while their crews threw bombs down. The thin ranks of redcoats wavered as in a breeze, and the mass of militia in the center almost broke. Men falling to their knees and covering their heads, though scarcely any real damage was done. So they already had planned to kind of use that to break their morale. A dozen guns were fired off, wildly. Shots wasted, Lawrence thought in despair, and the leading transport could make its descent almost unmolested. The four carriers drew closer together, flying in a tight knot directly above the transport, and let the keel of the vessel carve a resting place in the ground with its own momentum. The British soldiers in the front ranks threw up their arms as an immense cloud of dirt burst into their faces, and then almost at once half of them fell dead. The whole front of the transport had unhinged like a barn door, and a volley of rifle fire erupted from inside to mow down the front lines. A shout of "Vive l'Empereur!" went up as the French soldiers poured out through the smoke. More than 1,000 men, dragging a pair of 18-pounders with them. The men formed into lines to protect the guns as the artillerymen hurried to bring their charges to bear. The redcoats fired off an answering volley, and a few moments later the militia managed a ragged one of their own. But the Frenchmen were hardened veterans. Though dozens fell dead, the ranks shut tight to fill in their places, and the men held their ground. The four dragons who had carried the transport were flinging off their chains. Free of their burden, they rose again to join the fight, leaving the British aerial forces even more outnumbered than before. In a moment, another transport would land under this increased protection, and its own carriers worsened the situation further. Maximus roared furiously, clawed free of the Grand Chevalier, and made a sudden, desperate stoop towards the next transport as it began to descend. No art or maneuver, he only flung himself down. Two smaller dragons tried to bar his way, but he had committed his full weight to the dive. Though he took raking blows from their claws and teeth, he bowled them apart by sheer force. He was only knocked aside. One was only knocked aside. The other, a red and blue barred Hondor, tumbled against the cliffs with one wing splayed helplessly. It scrabbled at the ragged stone face, sending powdery chalk flying as it tried to get purchase to climb up onto the clifftop. A light frigate of some 24 guns with a shallow draft had been daring to stay near the coast. Now she leapt at the chance before the dragon could get up over the cliff's edge. Her full, double-shotted broadside roared out like thunder. The French dragon screamed once more over the noise and fell, broken, the unforgiving surf pounding its corpse and the remnants of its crew upon the rocks. Wow! All right, the British Navy gets in the fight a little bit. Above, Maximus had landed on the second transport and was clawing at the chains. His weight was too much for the carriers to support. But they were struggling valiantly, and with a great heave in unison, they managed to get the transport over the edge of the cliff as he finally broke the supports. The wooden shell fell 20 feet through the air and cracked open like an egg, spilling men and guns everywhere. But the distance was not great enough. Survivors were staggering to their feet almost at once, and they were safely behind their own already established line. You can see, like, the brilliance of this. If dragons were real and this whole thing, you know, was to happen, this pretty well carried out so far. Well planned. Maximus had landed heavily behind the British lines. His sides were steaming in the cold air, blood running freely from a dozen wounds and more, and his wings were dropped to the ground. He struggled to beat them again, to get aloft, and could not, but fell back onto his haunches, trembling in every limb. So Maximus is out of the fight. Wow. 3,000 or 4,000 men already on the ground and 5 guns. The British troops massed here only 20,000, and most of those militia, who were plainly unwilling to charge in the face of dragons above. Many men were already trying to run. If the French commander had any sense at all, he would scarcely wait for another 3 or 4 transports to launch his own charge. And if his men overran the gun emplacements, they could turn the artillery against the British dragons and clear the approaches completely. "Lawrence," Temeraire said, turning his head around, "two more of those vessels are going to land." "Yes," Lawrence said low. "We must try and stop them. If they land, the battle on the ground is lost." Temeraire was quiet a moment, even as he turned his path of flight into an angle that would bring him ahead of the leading transport. Then he said, "Lawrence, we cannot succeed, can we?" The two forward lookouts, young ensigns, were listening also, so that Lawrence had to speak as much to them as to Temeraire. "Not forever, perhaps," Lawrence said, "but we may yet do enough to help protect England. If they're forced to land one at a time, or in worse positions, the militia may be able to hold them for some time." Temeraire nodded, and Lawrence thought he understood the unspoken truth. The battle was lost, and even this was only a token attempt. "And we must still try, or we would be leaving our friends to fight without us." "And we must still try. Or we would be leaving our friends to fight without us," Temeraire said. "I think this is what you have meant by duty all along. I do understand at least this much of it." "Yes," Lawrence said, his throat aching. They had outstripped the transports and were now over the ground now, with the militia a blurred sea of red below. Temeraire was swinging about to face the first transports head on. There was only just enough time for Lawrence to put his hand on Tamarere's neck, a silent communion. The sight of land was putting heart into the French dragons. Their speed was increasing. There were 2 pêcheurs at the fore of the transport, roughly equal in size, and neither injured. Lawrence left it to Temeraire to decide which would be his target and reloaded his own pistols.
Temeraire stopped and hovered in midair before the oncoming dragons, spreading his wings as if to bar the way, his ruff raised instinctively up, the webbed skin translucent gray in the sunlight. A slow, deep shudder passed along his length as he drew breath and his sides swelled out even further against his massive ribcage, making the bones stand out in relief. There was a strange, stretched-tight quality to his skin, so that Lawrence began to be alarmed. He could feel the air moving beneath, echoing, resonating in the chamber of Temeraire's lungs. A low reverberation seemed to build throughout Temeraire's flesh, like a drumbeat rolling. "Temeraire," Lawrence called, or tried to. He could not hear himself speak at all. He felt a single, tremendous shudder travel forward along Temeraire's body, all the gathered breath caught up in that motion. Temeraire opened his jaws, and what emerged was a roar that was less sound than force, a terrible wave of noise so vast it seemed to distort the air before him. Lawrence could not see for a moment through the brief haze. When his vision cleared, he at first did not understand. Ahead of them, the transport was shattering, as if beneath the force of a full broadside, the light wood crackling like gunfire, men and cannons spilling out into the broken surf far below at the foot of the cliffs. His jaw and ears were aching as if they'd been struck on the as if he had been struck on the head, and Temeraire's body was still trembling beneath him.
"Lawrence, I think I did that," Temeraire said.
He sounded more shocked than pleased. Lawrence shared his sentiments. He could not immediately bring himself to speak. The four dragons were still attached to the beams of the ruined transport, and the four dragon to larboard was bleeding from its nostrils, choking and crying in pain. Hurrying to save the dragon, its crew cast off the chains, letting the fragments fall away, and it managed the last quarter mile to land behind the French lines. The captain and crew leapt down at once. The injured dragon was huddled and pawing at its head, moaning. Behind them, a wild cheer was going up from the British ranks, and gunfire from the French. The soldiers on the ground were shooting at Temeraire.
"Sir, we are in range of those cannons if they get them loaded," Martin said urgently.
Temeraire heard and dashed out over the water, for the moment beyond their reach, and hovered in place. The French advance had halted for a moment, several of the defenders milling about, wary of coming closer, as confused as Lawrence and Temeraire himself were. But in a moment, the French captains above might understand, or at least collect themselves. They would make a concerted attack on Temeraire and bring him down. There was only a little time left in which to make use of the surprise.
"Temeraire," he called urgently, "fly lower, and try if you can, striking at those transports from below, at cliff height. Mr. Turner," he said, turning to the signal ensign, "give those ships below a gun and show them the signal for engage the enemy more closely. I will believe they will take my meaning."
"I will try,"
Temeraire said. That's not Temeraire. I thought it was a signalman.
"I will try," Temeraire said uncertainly and dived lower, gathered himself, and once again taking that tremendous swelling breath.
Curving back upwards, he roared once again, this time at the underside of one of the transports still over the water. The distance was greater, and the vessel did not wholly shatter, but great cracks opened in the planks of the hull. The four dragons above were at once desperately occupied in keeping it from breaking open all the rest of the way. An arrow-headed formation of French dragons came diving directly towards them, some six heavyweight dragons behind the Grand Chevalier in the lead. Temeraire darted away and at Lawrence's touch dropped over the water, where half a dozen frigates and at least three ships of the line lay in wait. As they swept past, their long guns spoke in a rolling broadside. One gun after another, scattering the French dragons into shrill confusion as they tried to avoid the flying grapeshot and cannonballs.
"Yeah, British Navy!"
"Now quickly, the next one," Lawrence called to Temeraire, though the order was scarcely necessary. Temeraire had already doubled back upon himself. He went directly at the underside of the next transport in line.
the largest, flown by four heavyweight dragons, and with ensigns of golden eagles flying from the deck. "Those are his flags, are they not?" Temeraire called back. "Bonaparte is on there?"
"More likely one of his marshals," Lawrence shouted over the wind, but he felt a wild excitement anyway. The defenders were forming up again at a higher elevation, ready to come after them once more. But Temeraire beat forward with ferocious zeal and outdistanced them. This larger transport, made of heavier wood, did not break as easily. Even so, the wood cracked like the sound of pistol shot, splinters flying everywhere. Temeraire dived down to attempt a second pass. Suddenly Lily was flying alongside them, and Obvisaria on the other side, Lenten bellowing through his speaking trumpet,
"Go at them! Just go at them! We will take care of those damn buggers!"
And the two of them whirled to intercept the French defenders coming after Temeraire again. But even as Temeraire began his climb, fresh signals went up from the damaged transport. The four dragons who were carrying it together wheeled around and began to pull away. And across the battlefield, all the transport still aloft gave way and turned for the long and weary flight back in retreat to France. That's the end of chapter 12, the end of the epic, epic battle of book one. And we are on to the epilogue to close it out. Wow, we made it. This is the moment I think those of us who have read the book before were all waiting for. Super cool. Let's see how things wrap up in our final section. I think I'll try to do that in one taste. I think we can do that one more session. So thanks so much for those of you who have been reading along with me. I've got a couple other books like this and some more I might read as well. Please subscribe if you haven't already, and we will see you on the final epilogue session. Thanks.